So good evening everybody. Any one of you have come across any acute mountain sickness or a high altitude cerebral edema or high altitude pulmonary edema? Have you treated before? Anybody? Yeah. So first of all, we have to see how it develops and what are the reasons. Suppose you go to Ladakh area and you are not acclimatized, and suppose straightway by the air, or you are a trekker, you go and above, they say by the book, they say between 1500 above 2000 feet meter or above 8000 feet, they say. So you can develop acute mountain sickness, and they say by definition above 10,000 feet you can have pulmonary edema, or above 12,000 feet you can have cerebral edema. But this is not definite. You can have these things anything above 1500 meter. It all depends on how fit you are, what is your age, how much acclimatized you are, and if you are having any comorbidities. So these things are very important. So traditionally they say 2000 meter above threshold for high altitude illness. Rare cases, what I told, even if you ascend above 2000 meter, but below 2500 meter. So when we say acute mountain sickness, this is milder form, and this is severe form is HES, high altitude cerebral edema, and in between there is high altitude pulmonary edema. So both of these are life threatening. Now, so this is oxygenation at different altitude. So what they said in nutshell, inspired oxygen saturation, arterial oxygenation, and arterial oxygen saturation, all of them are decreased at this height. So what they say, differences between PO2 and PO2 narrows at high altitude because of increased ventilation. Fine. So what you see, partial pressure here, and SO2 and everything, PO2, PiO2, whenever you go high, so barometric pressures, so you have to breathe at the lower PiO2. Fine? Okay? Now, three things we were talking about: acute mountain sickness, high altitude pulmonary edema, and high altitude cerebral edema. Now, so if you talk about, this is the milder form. So generally occurs within 6 to 12 hours, but it may take 1 or 2 days also, symptoms usually resolve within 1 to 2 days when appropriate measures are taken. So what are the appropriate measures, anybody? So either suppose you are at the same height, so you can come down descending, one thing, or you can take prophylactically acetazolamide, they say, and oxygenation. So these things, they say even the NSAIDs work. So they are different theories, we will talk about. Now, so how, what happens, what is the pathophysiology? So hypoxia is there, there is brain vasodilatation is there, fine, and at the same time increased sympathetic activities are there. So what happens, increases cerebral blood flow, increases cerebral blood volume, fine, and at the same time water and sodium retention is there, just because of increased aldosterone and ADH activity. So what happens, finally it leads to autoregulation is impaired. See, these are vascular endothelial growth factor, INS, endothelium, these all are there, these are activated. So what they do, they increase blood brain permeability, and the last result is autoregulation is impaired, and finally over perfusion capillary pressure increases, and there is capillary leakage leading to acute mountain sickness and its severe form, high altitude cerebral edema. Fine. Now, the same thing, they are, it's all written here, altered brain blood permeability progressing to cytotoxic edema. They have talked about DGF, nitric oxide, cytokines are released. I'll show you the picture of MRI picture. There is T2 signal intensity in corpus callosum, especially posterior body and sphenium, and subcortical white matter. So you can have microhemorrhages, petechy, hemocytin debris, deposition, corticovenous thrombosis, herniation may occur. So high altitude cerebral, see what happens whenever you go anywhere, but sometimes you may have headache, sometimes you may have dizziness, sometimes you may have body ache. You think that what is happening, but you know, you don't know at what height you are. So suppose you have come across these things, you can treat somebody. But if you see, this is acute mountain sickness, the severe form can be high altitude cerebral edema. You must be knowing what are the signs and symptoms. That is important. Then only you can treat. So this is MRI finding. MRI reveals characteristic intense T2 signal in the white matter, especially the sphenium of the corpus callosum with no gray matter lesions, and MRI may remain abnormal for many days. Fine. So normally the MRI depicts this is a high altitude cerebral edema. Normally CT cannot, so MRI is definitive for this HES. Again, I talked about normally they say more than 8.5, but it can be, it's not faster, hard and fast. It can be above anything above 1500 meters. High altitude pulmonary edema above 10,000 feet. Normally, how much time it takes? 1 to 2 days. Suppose after ascent, they say in high altitude pulmonary edema after 3 to 4 days of your ascent, of after ascent, and high altitude cerebral edema they say 4 to 7 days. This is rough. This is nothing hard and fast. So what symptoms you can have? You can have lethargy, you can have sleep disturbances, loss of appetite, nausea, vomiting, headache, and pulmonary edema, the same thing. You can have weakness, you can have cough, and the characteristic is pink fluffy sputum. And this is AMS severe form is high altitude cerebral edema, can lead to confusion and hallucinations, and severe headache you can have. So treatment, what is treatment? So normally see, lot of things have been tried, but nothing is certain, but they have come up with this, lot of clinical trials have gone and they have done. Normally they say prophylaxis in all, estrazolamide, that it inhibits carbonic anhydrase. What it does? How it, mechanism of action, anybody? Normally what happens? Suppose patient hyperventilates, there is alkalosis, what it will urine will be more alkalotic and there will be acidosis, isn't it? Because it inhibits carbonic anhydrase. Now they say dexamethasone is also role in there. So these are the doses, 125 to 250 mg 12 hourly, dexamethasone 2 to 4 mg 6 hourly, and moderate to severe AMS in between, the same thing, you have to treat with dexamethasone, estrazolamide. And the most important, always remember, suppose HES, because it will occur at the highest, and suppose you have gone up to 12,000 feet or something more than that. So the important thing, first and all, if possible, there should be descent up to 5 meters. Then things will be improving. And what you have to do, because you have to supplement oxygen, because already there is low oxygen in the air, isn't it? FiO2 is low. So you have to supplement oxygen. And if possible, if patient is not recovering, you have to give portable hyperbaric O2 chamber, suppose higher pressure, so that the patient will be having more oxygen. And again, dexamethasone, they say, you can give IV, you can give IM, you can give parorally also, 8 mg, then you can use 4 mg IV, IM, parorally, 6 hourly. These are things, see, there is no hard and fast rule, but estrazolamide and dexamethasone, definitely they help. There are other drugs also, I will be talking about. Fine. Now this is high altitude pulmonary edema. What is definition? Definition is, first thing is non-cardiogenic. And what is that? There is caused by exaggerated hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction, caused by hypoxia. And abnormally high pulmonary artery pressures and capillary pressures. That will lead to the leakage. So these high pressures lead to non-inflammatory and hemorrhagic alveolar capillary leak, that secondly may evoke an inflammatory response. Important thing is, you know, pulmonary capillary wave pressure is normal. So non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, exaggerated hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction, and these high pulmonary artery pressures. So definition is very important, you should know. Now, pathophysiology again, there is this one, see, high altitude hypoxemia. So again the same like that AMS and HES, increased sympathetic activity are there, and there is pulmonary endothelial dysfunction in there. Because of nitric oxide activity and all, this activity is decreased basically. So what it happens, it increases pulmonary artery pressure, and when the sympathetic activity is increased, it increases pulmonary blood volume, pulmonary venous constriction there, increased aldosterone. So it all leading to regional overperfusion, leading to increased capillary pressure, and the last thing is capillary leakage is there. So then this develops high altitude pulmonary edema. So the first two things are same, and the mechanism, these are the things you have to remember. Now, so what are symptoms? At least two when you are going to diagnose, because it's a very difficult. Suppose somebody is having bronchial asthma, somebody is having COPD, and he is having these type of things, or some pulmonary problem, he is having comorbidities, hypertension, somebody is having kidney diseases. So difficult to diagnose. It's really difficult to diagnose. But what you will have a basic idea of how much height if the person has gone. Fine, ascent. So that will give a clue if person may be having some things before he was okay. So at least two of these, he will have difficulty breathing, dyspnea at rest. He may have cough, weakness or decreased exercise performance, and chest tightness or congestion. Yeah, these things he will be telling. And what are signs? You may be getting, definitely you will be getting crackles or wheezing in at least 1 month period. Definitely central sinusitis, because he has gone that high, so may develop sinusitis, may be tachycardic, may be tachypneic. Fine, these two you can have, and by the same history where he has gone. Fine, so you can have if a patient has developed this high altitude pulmonary edema. Now, the X-ray picture, what it tells, useful, reveals characteristic patchy infiltrates, all of you can see, predominantly the right central region, and which become more confident and bilateral as the illness progresses. Might be the initial picture, and bat wing edema, Kurli's B line, so those are the pulmonary edema. So you can see this, so difficult to differentiate, but the history and other things will tell you. Now, what are treatment? First important thing, first and all, rest, and another thing is descent. Descent is very important, if possible. If not possible, what you can give? Supplement oxygen you have to give. And suppose at that height, definitely it will be cold, you have to cold protection, hyperbaric bag, increase oxygenation at the higher pressures you have to give, atmospheric pressure. And this is BiPAP, as temporary, both EPAP and CPAP you can use. Nifedipine, they say they have got definitive role, even in the prophylaxis also. This one, tadalafil and sildenafil, these are 5D5 inhibitors. They say that lot of clinical trials have been done. They say it has got the definitive role, both either tadalafil or sildenafil, even nifedipine also. Dexamethasone, yes. Salmeterol, nebulization you can give, and patient improves. Definitely these drugs have been given. If you go through the literature, the clinical trials, definitely your patient is going to improve. But the most important is descent. Always remember, one only descent is possible, then oxygenation and other things followed by. Fine. Now, because see, estradiolamide prevention treatment, acute mountain sickness we have talked about, dexamethasone, yes, acute, yes, these are the doses, high altitude stable, these are the doses. Now nifedipine, they are telling prevention, what about prophylaxis and treatment also, 20 mg every day, it has got definitive role. Salmeterol in form of nebulization, and sildenafil 5D5 inhibitor, definitely both prevention and treatment, they say 20 mg every 68 hours, and the same group of that tadalafil 10 mg every 12 hours. So these are not written like this, it has got definitive evidence. If you go through the clinical trials they have done, so these drugs are beneficial. But the always remember, whether this is AMS, whether this is cerebral high altitude cerebral edema or pulmonary edema, the first thing is descent, then oxygenation, then these drugs. Fine. And the an important thing is your diagnosis should be very important. So now we have got other thing, heat stroke. So most of you might have treated somebody come across this heat stroke patient. So how you define this heat stroke? Important definition is important. So always remember, there is this thermoregulatory failure. When you compare it with heat exhaustion, in heat exhaustion there is this control is not gone, thermoregulatory control is not gone. But in case of heat stroke, this thermoregulatory failure is there. That is the important thing. And we talk about the temperature, normally above 40 centigrade, and there is CNS symptoms are there. Typical biochemical and physiological abnormalities, like you can have deranged LFT, deranged RFT, other things we were talking about. So, so most cases occur. So now they say, what is this? It can be in youths or it can be older ages. Fine. So in the sun, especially military, these are things, or elderly people who are ill, or severe heat waves. So it's not that maybe they are exciting, or patient is having CKD, CLD, any other disease, CHF, they can have, easily they can have this heat stroke. So mortality is as high as 70%. Fine. Now, How you diagnose? So normally core body temperature is more than 105. Patient is lethargic, patient is not responding, central nervous system dysfunction is there. Heat test is definitely either endogenous or exogenous. Then these are the DDs. What differential diagnosis you have rule out? You have to rule out CNS infection, you have to rule out sepsis, you have to rule out neuroleptic. Anybody? What is neuroleptic malignant syndrome? Antipsychotic drugs normally they develop, isn't it? Fine, they can have high fever, they can have. So how you differentiate between malignant hyperthermia and how this, you might have, most of you anesthesiologists are there, so might have seen this malignant hyperthermia, isn't it? So most of the halogenated agents or whatever you school in or whatever agents, bearing few agents, they can cause this malignant hyperthermia, and the treatment is mostly dantrolene, that is not available. Normally this is not available. So you have to, these, why these are things? Because this is a very high temperature in both these cases, even in sepsis. So whenever you are thinking about heat stroke, you have to keep in mind about all the DDs. Fine? And mark elevation hepatic transaminase, however this is not involved. So not in all cases you will be getting this. It all depends on how much time has been there, patient was lying, he has been left untreated, and what was the temperature not treated, then you can have this transaminase rise or kidney failure, or they are multi-organ failure, that is the end result. Now, so there are two definitions, one is exertional, fine, when is non-exertional, that is classical, fine. So classical normally in case of elderly or sick individuals, you have talked about any like a CLD, CKD, CHF, malignancy or whatsoever, and old individuals. And exertional normally younger individuals who are exercising, or normally in these cases they are having, what is difference, thermoregulative mechanisms are intact, but in this case there is definitely some impairment of thermoregulative control. Fine. Now, so causes we have talked about, this is the causes, physical condition, so not exertional, high ambient temperature, humidity, lack of air conditioning, old age, obviously more than 65 alcoholism, CHF, renal failure, diabetes, COPD, cystic fibrosis, thyrotoxicosis, hypokalemia, patient is dehydrated, has taken alcohol, anticholinergic drugs like atropine, amphetamines, beta-arphenones, cocaine, diuretics, hallucinogens, there is a big list there. So you have to differentiate between exertional causes and non-exertional causes. So classical is this one non-exertional, then you have got this exertional causes. Now, the pathophysiology, what it happens, normally what does this? Severe heat exposure causes cutaneous vasodilation, and when the cutaneous vasodilation, so the which circulation is impaired, normally the blood is drawn from the splenic circulation causing splenic vasoconstriction, and at the same time it causes increased ICP. Fine, these things lead to hypotension and CPP suffers. Normally what is CPP baseline you think? Around 60, isn't it? CPP is, what is CPP? Mean arterial pressure minus ICP, isn't it? So these things, what they say? So severe ischemia is there, hypoxia is there, decreased ATP, so glutamate, increased dopamine, these are the factor cytokines are released, these are the ROS, INS, RNS, these are things, these are activated. So what they happen? So there is oxidative stress is there, and what they cause neural damage, apoptosis, you know, because when the very high temperature is there, it can directly damage the cells, isn't it? So it apoptosis, necrosis and autophagy, and CNS dysfunction causing because the temperature is being controlled from hypothalamus, so hypothalamic dysfunction is there. Okay, and lastly multiple organ dysfunction, so everything leading to the, so you have to act here. When you finding there is cutaneous vasodilation with ICP, you can act here, because if you are acting here, you have lost your patient going into multi organ failure and all, means you have lost your patient. So you have to act here, you have to diagnose before to save your patient. Now what it can cause, what I was talking about right now, it can, the very high temperature, it can directly cause tissue thermal injury, necrotic apoptotic cell death, it can cause coagulopathies, fibrin deposition, excessive bleeding, and immune modulators are there. So these all can cause, these will cause, what do you mean by SIRS, anybody? What are the components? So you have, you know, why this SIRS important? SIRS, you have difference between SIRS and sepsis, isn't it? So it all lead to SIRS, but SIRS can lead to multi-organ failure and death. So in result, coagulopathies and immune modulators, everything is activated. So you have to act before and you have to diagnose, because it can be fatal. Now, what are the DDs? We have talked about delirium. What is delirium treatments, anybody? Alcohol, it's related with alcohol withdrawal. Fine. So this is neuroendocrine syndrome. Diabetic, you all know. Encephalopathic, both in hepatic and uremic encephalopathy, patient can be comatose. And these drugs, hyperthyroidism, toxicity, and salicylates. So you have to keep in mind when you are treating heat stroke, you have to keep in mind all these DDs. This can be the possibilities, and you have to rule out all these things. Now, I have talked before, heat exhaustion, the important difference between this is, there is thermoregulatory control is not lost, there it is lost. Fine. So here there is significant dehydration, may not be significantly heat stroke, and there is sensory and neurological examination, and in heat stroke there is definitive CNS involvement is there. Here it can be in heat exhaustion, can be prophylactic, and in that case initially there can be prophylactic and later there can be anhydrosis. This is important. So you have to remember, when you are different, one is temperature difference, in heat stroke there is more temperature, and here the thermoregulatory control is lost. In heat exhaustion thermoregulatory control is still there. Fine. And here you can have prophylactic, but in that case heat stroke you can have anhydrosis too in the later stages. Now treatment. Again, treatment remains, you have to cool and decrease thermogenesis. Is debatable and is controversy also, which technique is superior. But whatever you have in your setting, whichever setting you are, you have to treat the patient. Depends on resource ability available. That is important. Trising important. Suppose if you are not able, suppose you can send the patient, or do you think that definitely things are not going out of your control? So whatever you have to decrease temperature. And the important thing is, cooling should be stopped when you reach a temperature of 39. Always remember. Fine. And this clotrimazine has got to prevent shivering, but it can cause anybody. Clotrimazine can cause neuroleptic malignant syndrome. Fine. Not one dose, but it can cause. So cooling blankets are not recommended. They say dantrolene may be improving, but you know, dantrolene is not easily available, malignant hyperthermia and all. So in those cases, even neuroleptic malignant syndrome, these are the drug of choices. Even so, because the normal funda is, you have to use dantrolene to decrease the temperature. So whatever setup you are working, you have to decrease temperature, you have to cool. Other methods we are talking about, and cooling should be stopped once you reach at 39 degree centigrade. That is important. So these things we really apply ice pack, aspire packs. You can elevate feet with the body and cloth spray. So the normal thing is, you have to bring down the temperature, because it can be detrimental to the whole body. Now, so what we do, aggressive cooling with, you have to bring down temperature less than 101. Once you have done that, you have to remove clothing, remove from the hot environment. Then ice packs and all, temperature brought down. If the temperature has been brought down, then again you can go for the head CT. Suppose the patient is still comatose, you can do the head CT, you can do the ECG, you can do the CBC, LFT, RFT, whatever test you want to do. But if your patient has not temperature still high, then what other things? You can do this one, gastric lavage, pleural lavage, peritoneal lavage, whatever level, and ECMO, bypass, other things. Suppose these things have not worked and you are in a tertiary setup, you can use those things both to bring down the temperature. That is important. So normally what we do, you have to bring down the temperature. Now, patient, hyperthermic patient can have supraventricular tachyarrhythmias. Will you treat, will you give antiarrhythmics? Normally we don't give. Normally what you have to treat the etiology. Fine. So and digitally should be avoided. And important thing is, patient can go into hypotension. We have talked about, you have to give fluid, normal saline, and necessarily osteoprotenol. Okay, fine. And dopamine also should be, these all things should be avoided too. So normal thing is, you have to take, a patient is going down, you have to take care of ABCD, airway breathing circulation. So when you are talking about circulation, so and Fine. So next slide is, these hyperthermic patients can have seizures. So if they are throwing seizures, what you do? You treat with diazepam, and you know, normally what we, ABG we do at 37 degree centigrade. So you can have variations in that. So you have to accordingly. So your blood gas is done at that level can be deceptive. All of you remember. So but you have to administer bicarbonate and guided frequency obtain arterial blood gases. And I have what I have talked about ABC. If you think your patient is comatose, GCS is less than 8, patient can aspirate, you have to intubate the patient. Fine. And so to prevent from aspiration, urine output should be closely monitored. Suppose even if you are working primary setup, this is the easiest thing you can do. Mannitol and furosemide and serum potassium levels should be closely followed, because high potassium can cause ventricular fibrillation and patient can die. So these things should be monitored. Even the ABGs you are doing regularly, you can monitor all those things. Now, what do you have? Anybody polystyrene sulfonate? What is this? To decrease the potassium, to decrease the hyperkalemia, to counter the hyperkalemia. So if the potassium is high, you can use this. You can use PPI. And the worst thing is, if the patient has developed DIC, means your patient is going to die. So you have to prevent DIC. And the, once the coagulation parameters should be closely followed, like PT, INR, APTT, platelet, everything. And normally, there is no role of steroids. There is no role of steroid, and prophylactic antibiotics are not recommended. Because so fast, there won't be sepsis, isn't it? But if you think that the patient was having some taking history, you can accordingly, but normally no role of steroids and antibiotics. Now, when the mortality increases, what I told before, when your time spent at elevated temperature is more, suppose he was there, for, left there unattended for 6 to 7 hours, 10 hours, that, and anything dealing to treatment for only 2 hours may be likely to take death up to 70%. So mortality is very high, patient left. So, and again, the pre-morbid debility in higher maximum temperatures you have talked about, when ventricular fibrillation, DIC and coma lasting more than 68 hours, they say high lactate levels complicating hypothermia. So mortality is predictively increased. Fine. So these things are there. These are the bad prognostic factors like VF, ventricular fibrillation, DIC and other things. So you have to control the temperature. The, what they say, the crux is you have to control the temperature. Otherwise, once these things have developed, increased lactates, you have arrhythmias, you have DIC and all, so you are going to lose your patient. Now, the last thing I will talk about is hypothermia. When you say hypothermia, when the temperature is less than 35, okay? And it may be due to either all because of abnormal thermoregulation or heat loss. Patient may be having thermoregulatory failure, or there is increased heat loss due to overwhelming thermoregulatory capacity. So, now, so what are the contributors of hypothermia? So either increased heat loss, reduced heat production, or impaired or abnormal central thermoregulation, like in CNS disorders, patient has taken alcohol, CNS depressant, patient is uremic, patient has sepsis, patient is having malignancy. Then again, reduced heat production, like in endocrine disease, diabetic, or diabetic ketoacidosis, hyperpituitarism, these are very important. Hyperadrenalism, hypothyroidism. So again, the patient is coming. So when you have taken out the blood, you can send everything right from your T3, T4, TSH, ketones and everything. And suppose your patient is cachectic, malnutrition, hypoxemia is there, reduced neuromuscular activity there, extreme surface. So patient, what they say, there is reduced heat production and increased heat loss in cases of conduction, convection, radiation and evaporation. So always, whenever you are treating hypothermia, you have to remember all the important causes and then accordingly you have to treat. Now, severity. Mild, they say between 30 to 35. So less than 35, they say hypothermia. So mild is 30 to 35. Moderate is between 20 to 32. Severe is less than 28. So normally below 28 or less than 20, patient can have cardiac arrest also. Fine. Patient will have, according to the patient, have bradycardia, hypokalemia and everything. So how you classify? Then again, primary intact, there is thermoregulation intact. Secondary, abnormal thermoregulation. And tertiary is therapeutic hypothermia. Like anybody? When you say therapeutic hypothermia, when you do? In head injury cases, fine. Or some cardiac surgery cases, mental arch and other things are there. So there are three things: is intact thermoregulation is there. Second is abnormal thermoregulation, and one is when you are thraptic, that is thraptic hypothermia. Okay. Now, so clinical symptoms are there between 35 to 32. You know, patient will be conscious, shivering, and treatment remains same. Warm environment. Warm she drinks, so this is a milder form. When we say about two great impaired concept, not severing. Now here what you have to see, you have to merge the cardiac ECG monitoring continuously, you have to avoid arrhythmias, and you have to do the full body insulation, active external minimal invasive rewarming techniques, because at less than around 32 to 28 your patient can die also arrhythmias, and you can lose your patient. And when you say between 22 to 24, 28, so then again, in all these cases, always remember ABCD. So here you have to follow the airway management. Even if between 32 to 28, you have to see first your patient is conscious, where airways are intact, or he needs intubation. But this category, they say definitely airway management is required, and ECMO or CPP in case of the cardiac arrest that is effective to medical. Suppose the patient is hypothermic and you have to warm the patient. So these things, either cardiac bypass or ECMO, you can use to increase the temperature. Other things are failed. And less than 24, there are no vital signs, you have to do the CPR. And 3 doses of epinephrine, they say, and defibrillation. And suppose the patient cardiac, and this one, when the patient is, you have to revive your patient, you can use rewarm with ECMO or cardiac bypass. With external and alternative, so you have to be very careful, because you know all these things. The important thing is ABCD, airway, and you have to use according to your resources, whatever resources you have, to increase the temperature. And suppose you are in tertiary setup or you have ECMO or CPB, you can use all this. But definitely below 24, they say there is no vital signs, you have to do the CPR. Now, so you know what they are saying, cerebral metabolism falls by around 8%, every degree, 1 degree fall in temperature. So here you see in 20 degree with these things, so there will be more detrimental. 35, still you can revive your patient. So initially there will be confusion, then it will progress to coma, hyperreflexia. So if you are getting unreactive people, and the temperature is low, cerebral activity is absent below 20 centigrade. So normally below 20, you have to do the CPR. Cardiac output again, it's half that 20 degree centigrade. There will be AF around 30, they say slow ventricular rate, DF at less than 28, and asystole, cardiac arrest, below 20. So you have to be very careful. Again, there will be increasing PR time, QRS interval, QTC interval. Then you will be getting Osborne J wave, that is below 33, they say. So initially there will be, when it's 35 degree temperature there, heart rate will be increasing and all contractile increase, but when you go to this side, 20, between 30, so you will be getting all things. So pulmonary edema and apnea you will be getting when you are approaching 20, 28. Initially you will have tachypnea and minor ventilation increase. Later on there will be respiratory depression. Last you will be getting pulmonary edema and apnea. And your hematologically you are talking about, there will be fluid shift compartments with hemoconcentration be there, reduced platelet aggregation adhesion. And the last, hypercoagulability and DIC, that is fatal, leading to multi-organ failure. So you have to keep in mind, whenever you are 35 or so, what they say, again, whenever you are treating hypothermic patient, ABCD, so you have to increase the temperature, warm the patient, and at the same time, continuously monitor vital signs, ECG and all, so, and if needed, you have to intubate the patient. So always keep in mind, if the sensorium is low, patient is not responding, you have to protect the airway, intubate, and other things you have to follow. Whatever facility and whatever setup you are working. So now they are telling immunologically, because you know, so they are immunocompromised. The hypothermic patient behaves like a immunocompromised patient. So hepatic and splenic sequestration there, thrombocytopenia and leukopenia will be there. So this is diagnostic, thrombocytopenia, leukopenia, immune dysfunction will be there. And you know, so initially, you know, there will be NP increase with around 35 and diuresis, and lastly there will be acute tubular dysfunction when they approach temperature is approaching around 20. So pancreatitis, lactic and ketoacidosis, around 35 there will be decreased GI motility. You know, so hypothermic patient, you can have gastric dilatation. Fine. So all because of decreased GI motility. and the all drugs metabolism are reduced. Catecholamines initially there will be less insulin secretion and insulin resistance, so sugars will be high. Initially the catecholamine and cortisol secretion increased, but when you approaching towards the 20 degree and all this time, the catecholamine and cortisol secretion will be less. And initially there is shivering. When you are approached towards 28-20, there will be loss shivering and there will be rhabdomyolysis leading to renal failure and multi organ failure whatsoever. So here you will be getting shivering, here will be vasoconstriction. Now important thing is whenever you are doing the ABG, you have to be very careful because you are doing at 37 centigrade, so this can be deceptive. Your ABG reading, your PT, even your PT, INR or whatsoever, they can be normal but they can be deceptive because at that temperature you have taken out the blood. So a hypothermic patient actually have lower PO2 and PCO2 than values derived from blood gas analysis performed, because normally those are done at 37, but the patient can be hypoxic, patient can have lower PCO2 and PO2, okay. And even the PTINR whatsoever, even the patient can be anemic. So those results, whatever the blood you are drawing, can be deceptive. Now again, always think about whenever you are approaching towards 24 20 28 24 20, patient can go into cardiac arrest. Always think of asystole unreactive pupil reflexia. Severe hypothermia can lead to all these things, asystole unreactive pupils and reflexia. So even though they say if you do CPR, there are reported outcomes are there, because if you go towards, you know, you the extremes of ages, okay, you cannot, because younger child you can revive the patient, but the extremes of ages like 90-80 year old, you can lose your patient. So they say despite that those things are available, you have to do the CPR and aggressive rewarming you have to do, because the base causes, do the CPR, but you have to increase the temperature. Rewarming important, restoring perfusion, cardiac rhythms in patient with BF, because hypothermia can cause all this BF or BT, and also resolve bacterial anemia, because can lead to blocks and bradycardia, hypokalemia, everything will be there. So, but the basic thing is you have to take care of the airway, you have to do the arrhythmia, and don't forget you have to increase the temperature. Whatever methods you have, whatever setup you are working. Now, so for patients with intact thermodynamic mechanism more than 34, passive rebar alone may be adequate. But when you think that with less than 34, you have to do the active external rewarming. Less than 30, you know, the extracorporeal techniques like ECMO and all, even the intravenous catheter or central line through that, whatever techniques you have, or the IV fluids, warm IV fluids, blankets, whatever you can use. Suppose more than 34, they say you can passively rewarm the patient, but the temperature comes down, you have to do, and last not the least is extracorporeal techniques like CPB, like ECMO and all. So ECMO and CPB you are having, you both, it can work in hypothermia and hyperthermia equally, fine. Now these are some methods. Warming more than 24, they say, and they say it increases 0.5 to 1 degree centigrade per hour. Cooling same time. Active extra warming you can do through warm exposed air blankets. You can use water circulating heating control blanket, radiant heaters, temperature control pads. They all retain, it can increase up to 1 degree centigrade per hour, maximum by 3. The cooling you can do again 1.5 to 3, these things you can do. Active internal, they say humidified warm inspired gases. When you have intubated the patient, you can give humidified warm gases, that, but that is not very effective, but it will at least increase to 0.5 to 1 degree per hour. Intravascular temperature control catheter, what I was talking about, so you can use all those things 2 to 4 degree. But last not the least is extracorporeal. They renal replacement therapy, they say 5 degree, and the most effective is cardiopulmonary bypass, that can increase 10 degree temperature per hour. And the cooling, the same way, you can use cool intravenous fluids, you can use, you can use intravenous temperature control catheter, body lavage, you can do the gastric lavage, you can do the pleural lavage, you can do the peritoneal lavage. But last of the list is renal replacement therapy. Again, few cases and all, you can do the what setup I am working with. Dr. Saxena, nephrologist, he told me when he working AIMS, he has saved so many patients long 20 years back. People coming from Jammu and Kashmir, they were hyperthermic. He used to do the peritoneal lavage, peritoneal dialysis used to do, and used to bring down the temperature. He has saved so many patients. So now I remember, these things are very important. Whatever methods you are having, you can use those things both in hypothermia and hyperthermia.
Thank you so much, sir. Any questions for sir? Thank you, sir. So tomorrow we'll reassemble at 8 a.m. sharp. People who want to tour the ICU, just wait for, I'll take you around.